Hi, I'm Ira Hammerman, Executive Vice President and General Counsel at SIFMA, and proudly an Executive Committee member of the SIFMA Compliance and Legal Society. It is my pleasure to welcome you to a special presentation commemorating the 50th anniversary of the very first CNL annual seminar. It was 1968. The very first Boeing 747 jumbo jet had just rolled off the assembly line. Now, I was not at the very first seminar, but I have been to every one since 1987. Now, in the interest of full disclosure, I did leave early once when my middle son was born. I hope you can forgive me. In any event, the annual seminar has grown tremendously over these 50 years. It started out with fewer than 100 attendees, and today we have over 2,000 from all across the country. Over these next few minutes, we're going to walk down memory lane. SIFMA prides itself on its relationship with the Compliance and Legal Society, a relationship that has grown over the years and today is as strong as ever. So please sit back and enjoy the presentation. Thank you.
Going back, you say 1968 is when you first started. You know, the late 60s, it was known for a paperwork crisis or back office crisis. What do you recall from that period of time?
In 1969, the average volume on New York Stock Exchange hit 13 million shares, and the processing was not able to handle it.
I actually started in this industry in the 1950s. I worked in the basement, and the salesman above would go ahead and take an order from you as a client. 100 shares, General Motors, purchase. They would write that on a ticket. They'd put it in a pneumatic tube, send it down a shaft. It would get to the basement. My job was to take that piece of paper out, and if it said purchase, I put it in P's. If it said sale, I put it in S's.
At that time, every trade involved a physical stock certificate and had to be carried by a messenger. So firms got overwhelmed. There fails to deliver and fails to receive. Hundreds of millions of dollars of securities were stolen. And what happened was the exchange had to close down one day a week, had to have people work overtime, nights and weekends, in order to try to figure out who was buying and who was selling securities.
The paperwork crisis was one of the biggest financial exposures that had come since World War II. My CEO at NASDAQ and NASD, a guy named Frank Zarb, Frank was an operations person during those years and told a lot of stories about the horrors of really not knowing what you owned.
1/6 of all the broker-dealers went out of business or were merged because of this crisis. And the SEC used this gestalt approach where they actually conditionally suspended firms and imposed certain regimes to have the firms clean up the mess, but not have a run on the broker-dealers by announcing it publicly.
The paperwork crisis was sort of a first step of understanding the importance of what technology was going to mean to the securities industry over time.
As I was entering the industry, certainly in the early 1980s, there were many insider trading investigations, and the SEC was at the forefront.
As I recall, there was an anonymous letter coming out of Caracas.
I want to show you a letter that went to Merrill Lynch.
Sure, no, I definitely have recollections. This gave information indicating that one of the clients was taking advantage of information.
It turned out to be a huge event for the SEC enforcement program. My most vivid recollection of that was probably meeting with the Attorney General of the Bahamas. My recollection is within 24 hours, we had the name of Dennis Levine, who was an investment banker who was responsible for the trading of the account. But in connection with our discussions on the settlement, his lawyers alluded to the fact that he had other people that he could give up in return for getting a more lenient treatment. And he sure did. Pointed us to Ivan Boesky and actually into others as well, his co-conspirators in the trading, you know, which led to these other big cases. We were hunkering down for a huge battle with Boesky. I remember I was on vacation and got a call from Boesky's lawyer, who was Harvey Pitt, saying that he wanted to meet.
Ivan Boesky was very controlling, and we would walk into meetings, and he would have a list, an agenda as long as your arm, of things that he wanted to discuss before we could get down to what we thought were the really important things, namely representing him.
One of the things in those enforcement programs at the time was the remedy civilly was only disgorgement, and either an injunction or being barred from the industry. So the U.S. attorney started getting involved in those cases and bringing in criminal cases, and we had to negotiate with both the SEC and the Department of Justice.
And, you know, that was the beginning of the end for Ivan Boesky. And then, of course, the number of people that he was able to testify against was much, you know, much larger and, frankly, much more significant than the Dennis Levine cooperation.
I guess the bull market's over, huh?
It was an exciting time of innovation. Futures markets had a couple years before begun getting involved in financial futures, and particularly with respect to stock index futures.
On the date of the stock market crash in 87, I was at the Futures Industry Expo, which was a way to bring attention to the technologies.
We started to see in 1987 and really at the beginning in 86, more and more indications of dramatic short-term volatility. But the real events started with a tumultuous day on the Friday before Black Monday. There was very significant losses in higher volume, putting firms under significant exposure over the weekend. I can remember that on that Monday morning, it looked like it was going to be a very, very bad opening.
And all of a sudden, just this panic set in.
And I can remember fear on the faces down on the floor, total quiet in the room, and just red. Everything red for an hour as the market simply sunk and sunk to the final loss of over 500 points.
A lot of the customers were calling in to put their orders in, and the firms were sending them, and there was this long period of time, several days in many cases, where they didn't know if the orders were executed or not.
It was the beginning, I think, of a real change in regulators' focus on systemic issues rather than purely micro or institutional issues.
It's 8:52 here in New York. I'm Bryant Gumbel. We understand that there has been a plane crash on the southern tip of Manhattan. You're looking at the World Trade Center. We understand that a plane has crashed into the World Trade Center. We don't know anything more than that.
It was an aircraft that crashed into the Pentagon.
Two airplanes have crashed into the World Trade Center.
On 9/11, our building was right next to the Trade Center. I saw the second plane hit, and we evacuated 9,000 people. We lost three, three died, but we evacuated 9,000. We got a call from the police saying that the five of us who had remained had to leave, and then we hit the street, and then you saw the great tragedy going on the street.
And I remember looking out the window south from the 27th floor, and I saw the first tower go down.
I walked to the market site, which had been closed, because you still didn't process really what was happening.
We had our own issues here in Washington. Standing on the balcony of the NASD building, you could see streets full of people leaving the White House, leaving Capitol Hill, trying to get as far away as they could. We, of course, jumped into the regulatory relief mode and gave relief from just a wide range of things that there's no way anybody should have to be concerned with during that period of time.
When you push all the tears aside, you still had 50,000 people working for you. How do you keep the business going? How do you service your clients? And the New York Stock Exchange had the same problem. How do they get their business going?
The initial effort was to try to get open in the same week, because it seemed important.
The Secretary of Treasury, his goal was to try and encourage the exchange to open up immediately to show those who try to destroy us that they didn't succeed. The problem with that good notion was that you couldn't even get to the New York Stock Exchange because of the debris on the streets. And if you started up and all of a sudden your computers went down, that would be a worse disgrace than if you just waited over the weekend, which they did.
I made the decision that we should use the weekend to test the markets with faux orders. And we did find a lot of glitches. Many of the same people who had handled prior crises at the commission were able to work with the financial community. And we fixed the kinks in the system. And by Monday, we had a high level of confidence that everything would go well.
And I can remember that next Monday being some of the scariest but proudest moments as we made it through that day. And I think that day really made a statement for what the financial industry was able to contribute in a terrible time to belief and confidence in America.
As terrible of a time as that, the tragedy, the loss of life, the ability to resolve ourselves and get there and get back on our feet, I think was just astounding.
A tough period of time, no doubt, but appreciate your sharing your perspective. Fast forwarding again several years, more squarely in the financial arena, the Great Recession time period.
Sure. It was actually a couple of months where things were very dicey. And it culminated a weekend that I spent at the Fed, and it became pretty clear that firms were not going to pony up $3 or $4 billion each to do the bailout. That was it. You know, and I think Lehman went into bankruptcy that night.
And I remember after the government allowed Lehman to fail, being down on the floor of the exchange, watching, probably the first time since 87, that I saw pure fear in the traders' faces on the floor of the exchange. And you watched the stocks going, the firms that you were confident would always be there, and thinking, I don't know if there's a bottom before zero.
Look, it was for everybody, I think, a terrifying time. And I'm sure you can recall wondering every Saturday and Sunday what was going to have to happen before the Asian markets opened on Sunday night.
The steps that the Fed took to blow through a variety of time frames and rules and suddenly make Morgan Stanley and Goldman Sachs bank holding companies was sort of what I'd call the moment of leveling off of pressure.
It was, well, without question, the most harrowing couple of weeks that I've ever spent in my professional life.
Sure. And Morgan Stanley became a bank holding company.
We did, yeah. I remember signing, over that period, I was asked to sign the application. And it was like, you know, at least a foot and a half, maybe 2 feet high. And there was, you know, I don't know how many times I had to sign. But in a normal setting, you'd probably plan for 3 years before you actually converted to become a bank holding company. We did it in like a 48-hour period.
The industry was able to rebound fairly quickly, and I think that's a testament to the underlying strength of the U.S. market structure, not just its depth and liquidity or its sophistication, but also the compliance function as part of it to keep the industry working within the rule set that policymakers establish. So I think the trajectory, while it's certainly been a changing one, has been a positive one.
Based on a thorough investigation, including intense due diligence, we have confirmed that what today is Squire's used to be known as the famous Wolf's Delicatessen, where on a regular basis, the original founding members of the Compliance and Legal Society would meet to discuss the day's problems and try to solve them.
If I asked you kind of what's a key memory or a time that you had at CNL over the years, and anything come to mind?
Two things come to mind. One, your father and mother hosting during the March Madness pizza parties at their suite so we could actually watch the games and actually enjoy ourselves. And this other thing, which I actually took more seriously, is people in small groups and rooms go into the detailed discussions. And that, to me, was always the value of that conference.
The camaraderie, the opportunity to meet other people who were dealing with these issues on a day in and day out basis. That, to me, was the real strength of the SIFMA CNL program.
I can remember wandering into a breakout session. On the podium were Ted Levine and Bob Mendelsohn in t-shirts, baseball caps pushed backwards, firing through questions with basically 150 people with incredible capability and alacrity. And I thought, this is an industry that actually wants to get better. And it also showed the dynamic difference from all the horribly boring conferences where you sat a few people up and you had talking heads talking to what the C&L conference was all about.
If you look back to when the compliance and legal division at that time of SIA was set up, compliance was not really viewed with professionalism and the importance that it is today. And the professionalism and the importance of the compliance career has in part been facilitated by the society.
I think our lawyers and our compliance professionals keep this industry on the right track. They are important bulwark against misconduct and bad actors.
I always thought that between us at the SEC and your organization, there was a kind of relationship that we both want to be doing the right thing.
There's always a negative context of this bad thing happened, this bad thing happened. But the fact is, all the years I was in the business, it is primarily made up of good people, people that you can trust, people who gave you their word. And it should be made known how good the people in the industry are and how well they've done over these many, many years.